And this is number three. I'm using as the basis this book right here, Seven Men Who Ruled the World from the Grave by Dave Breese. And you can read along with that if you want to, or you can just listen along. And today we come to one that you may not know as well as you know some of the others, Karl Marx and Charles Darwin, thank you. I've had a blank there. Charles Darwin and Karl Marx, both, of course, are known almost exclusively by anyone. But today we come to Julius Wellhausen. And Julius Wellhausen is perhaps one of those names you say, who? But I think I'll be able to show you today that Julius Wellhausen had an unbelievable influence, in fact, still does today have an unbelievable influence on the church, whereas Marx and Darwin had an influence on the world in general. Wellhausen's influence was completely on the church, and yet it completely changed the church, and I think to the worse, and we'll see how that comes today. But when you think of Western society, in Western society, if we were to have a class perhaps on Western civilization, you used to have to take that in high school or college, right? Western civ. And what is Western civilization? I don't think you could understand nor explain Western civilization without Christianity. You would just have to have a discussion of Christianity. Otherwise, you're really not talking about Western civilization, because Western civilization was built on, by, for, and to the Christian world. And the good, bad, and the ugly, it's Christianity is at the root of it and foundation of it. In fact, try to explain Europe without Christianity, and you simply cannot do it. The French tried to get away from it and did an inglorious job of it in the French Revolution, but you simply can't do it. If you were to take a tour of the history of Europe, what would be some of the likely places you would go? Not necessarily towns, but you'd go to castles and churches, castles and cathedrals. That would be the history of Europe would be right there. Castles and cathedrals and some war fields. And war memorials. That would be the history of Europe. So we have really Western society that was built on Christianity, and Christianity built Western society. And in the past, Western society and the thought process of Western society was built on what we would call orthodoxy. There would be Orthodox Christianity, Orthodox, I'll call it Catholicism, Orthodox Catholicism in the Roman part of the world. And after 1517, then you would have Orthodox Protestantism in another part of Europe, but Orthodoxy, one or the other, and then in small pockets or in a different form, you would have Orthodox Judaism. So Orthodox Protestantism, Orthodox Catholicism, Orthodox Judaism. That was Europe, and Europe was, of course, Western society. And then some of that came here. But in all of those, Orthodox Catholicism, Protestantism, or Judaism, an understanding that the Bible was a word of God. I realize we have great disagreements with the Catholics, and even great disagreements with the Protestants, and great disagreements with the Jews. But nonetheless, all of them trusted the Bible to be the authoritative word of God. All three of those groups would have said the earth was made, or the creation was made in 6 days, and on the seventh day God rested. And they would get that because of their view of Scripture. They believed that God revealed how the world came about, and so that made up the foundation of who we are. And it was all of this orthodoxy that basically settled the big questions of man, like who are we? Who is God? How did we get here? What's our purpose in life? And a big part of civilization, of course, is the question is, what is government, or what's the form of government, or what's the role of government? And that was all answered by Christianity. Now, suppose that you remove Christianity, and then you ask society, what is man? What is God? What is government? Those three very key questions. Without a basis of orthodoxy, then what do you come up with what is man? I saw and made a little fun of over the weekend on Facebook, because Facebook is the place to make fun of things, grand opening today. By the way, it's at 4 o'clock today here in Vidito, I think, of goat yoga. I'm not exactly sure. I think there's a name for it.
Nama yoga,
or as some of us call it, stupid yoga. But anyway, you do the yoga with goats, I don't know, until you get rammed in the rear end with one of them. I don't know exactly how this works. Pardon me for making fun of it if you're a Nama yoga instructor. But then I'll make fun of you next. But anyway, in this the introduction of the grand opening of the Nama yoga, there was a statement about our brothers and sisters, the plants and animals. Now, I have a brother and I have a sister, but I didn't know brothers and sisters were the plants and animals. Now, where do you come up with that kind of sort of out there kind of thinking? I tell you, you remove Christianity and you still have to answer the question, who are we? Where'd we come from? And when you answer that question without Christianity, of course, you just make stupid stuff up. And sometimes you make it up by yourself and sometimes you make it up by committee. And you just decide, okay, this is who we are. So that therefore leads to, in a Darwinian worldview, well, we are brothers and sisters with the plants and animals. That's very much Darwinian, because we all came from the same little original speck of matter. And we just sort of evolved in different ways, but we all started out the same thing. So that's Christianity without a basis of revelation. That's not Christianity. That's the world without the basis of revelation. And that really is so much where the world is today. And unfortunately, I think as you put a trajectory on this thing, it eventually comes to anarchy. You see, it comes down to what is there a government, what kind of government, and you eventually end up with anarchy. The problem is that anarchy is always followed by totalitarianism. And so the forward look on this thing, honestly, is not very good. If we were writing the history of the United States in the future, if we could write it now, the picture doesn't look good, and of Europe, honestly, looks even worse, because Europe's ahead of where we are, if you want to use that that term. Well, in Western society today, and again, this is very clear in Europe and increasingly clear in the United States, in Western society today, what we have is, as many have called it, a post-Christian world. You have Western society less the Christianity, and that is removed. Now, you've still got the vestiges of Christianity. You've got that in Europe. And of course, you would go again to Europe and you would see the great cathedrals. And yet, the cathedral is a museum or a restaurant or a hotel or, you name it. This is what it is. I quoted from an article just last year in the Wall Street Journal, says every denomination, this is on the U.S. side, every denomination in the U.S. is losing both affiliation and church attendance. In some ways, the country is a half generation behind the declining state of Christianity in other Western countries like the U.K., Australia, Germany, Sweden, Norway, France, and the Netherlands. In those countries, what were once churches are now art galleries, cafes, and pubs. In Germany, more than 50% say they do not believe in any God, and this number is declining rapidly. In the UK, church attendance has halved since the 1970s. Now, is mostly about the UK. The whole article was about church buildings being sold because there's no use for them as church buildings anymore. And it really was focusing on the United States, because even in the United States, there is no, I think you can say that just that emphatically, there is no part of Christianity that is better off today than it was 10 years ago. Zero. No denomination. No movement. Nothing. It is all dying. 100% of Christianity is dying. There are buildings. There are choirs. There are dusty organs that haven't been used in ages. There are, you know, all this, but it's all gone. And I think we, especially because we're a group of people who grew up in church and we're here all the time, And we might get disturbed every now and then. You'd look around and say, well, you know, there's not as many people as there used to be. Or, you know, I remember when we used to have revivals and we'd fill the house. We try to figure out, well, what's gone wrong? And typically we say, what have we done wrong? And typically then we lead to some bad results in that we get together and say, well, what is it we need to do to get more people here? And what we need to do to get more people here is to do stupid stuff, and it gets more people, and we started doing that in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, and we just keep getting more and more stupid. How many times can a pastor use the word stupid in one lesson? There's a lot of stupidity going on anyway. And the problem is not just this church or that church or the pastor here or the denomination there, whatever it is you try to blame it on. The problem is that Western society is rejecting Christianity. And Julius Wellhausen actually has to do with this. We'll get to him in a moment. Dave Breese says, the idea that God was in the midst of it all and that he revealed himself in his inspired, infallible word, that idea that life slipped through the finger, that idea that life slipped through the fingers of an unsuspecting church. What happened, to put that in context, he says, somewhere along the way, the unsuspecting church let out of its grasp the idea that there is a transcendent God who has revealed himself in his word. And that is gone now. And so religious liberalism came in its place. Religious liberalism is, in a sense, not even Christianity, because they completely don't even have the same concepts as, say, you know, our mother, our grandmother, all that kind of stuff. It's completely different. Well, where did religious liberalism come from? And again, the foundational point is religious liberalism has killed Christianity, and the lack of Christianity is suicide for Western culture. We honestly just are killing our culture. And again, you can see this in Europe. If you want to see it firsthand, go to Europe and you'll see it. And you see, I think, a whole lot of it, even right here in the United States. Well, the father of religious liberalism is a fellow named Julius Wellhausen, who was born in 1844, died in 1918. And was considered to be a scholar's scholar. He was from Germany and served most of his life and ministry in Germany. And he brought about a change in Christianity, even in Baptist Christianity. He brought about a change in Christianity that cannot be understated. Everyone who wants to know the decline of the American church or the Western church or the Christian church needs to go back to Julius Wellhausen. And basically what he brought about was a new way of understanding the Bible. To make it a long story short, in case I lose you here, the old way was the Bible is revelation that we trust has come from God. The new way of looking at the Bible is human reason needs to analyze the Bible and determine what is true and what is not true. This, of course, is a completely different view of the nature of Scripture. And so before Wellhausen, if you were to ask, and this would be true in the Roman Catholic world, and again, we disagree with a lot of their conclusions, and we disagree with their reliance upon tradition and whatnot, but the Roman Catholic world, the Orthodox Protestant world, even the Orthodox Jewish world, as long as you're talking about the Old Testament, if you were to ask them, if the Bible was true and inerrant, before Wellhausen, go to any church, any Orthodox thing somewhere, and say, is the Bible inerrant? And the answer would be yes, 10,000 times yes, absolutely. Why'd you even ask such a dumb question? I use dumb instead of stupid. Because everyone recognized the Bible as true and inerrant, and would have said that if we look at the Bible and it doesn't seem to line up with our secular histories, or we can't find the archaeological evidence for it or whatever, before Wellhausen, everyone would have said, well, man's reason is fallible, and so we're looking at this wrong. Think about it long enough, wait long enough, be patient long enough, archaeology will find it, or science will find it, or something, and the Bible, in the end, will be proven to be correct. That's what everyone would have said. Now, that changed somewhere along the way, hopefully not with you, but that did change somewhere along the way, and Wellhausen was the leader of that. He was the leader of a group that was called German Rationalism. German Rationalism. German Rationalism is going to end up being the same thing as higher criticism, a term we'll use here in just a moment. But German Rationalism is the opposite of biblical revelation. One, again, is God from above gave us his word. The other is man comes together to figure this out. And so German rationalism said that the Bible is a sublime collection of human documents. It's just this wonderful library of human documents. So, as we'll see in a moment, take the first five books of the Bible. We would say, ultimately, that God wrote them through the pen, if I can use a little anachronism there, through the pen of Moses. Okay, that shows that you have not bought into German rationalism, because German rationalism says, no, there's no way Moses could have written that, and he didn't write that. In fact, they would talk about these four various authors that wrote, and it's this sublime collection of human human documents. The story of Adam and Eve, for example, prior to Wellhausen, again, everyone, Jew, Protestant, Catholic, everyone would have said that Adam was a real person. He lived in a real garden called Eden, and he had a real wife whom we call Eve. And so it was two people, two individuals, and that's who they were. Now, after Wellhausen, it came to be, no, this is a story. It is a story to give us a representative idea of man and where he came from, or where man thought he came from, at least. And Adam was not a real person. In fact, I can go back to the textbook that I had at the Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary on Old Testament survey, and it has several pages describing how Adam is just the Hebrew word for mankind, and Eve is the Hebrew word for womankind. And so mankind came along and womankind came along. Now, the problem with mankind coming along and womankind coming along is that we can't go back and define sin by an individual that introduces sin into the world, can we? Because if you've got one man, you can go back to the source, then you've got sin. And if you've got sin, then you've got the consequences of sin. And if you've got the consequences of sin, you have to have a redeemer. And if you have a redeemer, then you've got Christ and Christianity. So you start at the beginning and kill that. It's going to end up with, you don't even need Christ on the cross in order to be saved. What they will say is, what you need is just a better understanding of yourself. With a better understanding of yourself, you can lift yourself up and you can basically save yourself. And Christ may have been, if they say he was a historical figure, they say, well, he was a wonderful example of how we ought to be self-serving, self-sacrificing, and give to better mankind. And this is how you save yourself, just like Christ saved himself. You see this. Now, I gave, I'm not going to show the little YouTube clip, but if you go to the trouble of putting all those little letters in there on the outline and put that in, there is a clip of a young man named Jefferson Bethke. Some of you might know that name, and you may not, because we tend to be too old in this room. But Jefferson Bethke is one of the cool young hip, very popular among millennial kinds of, I guess you'd call him preacher. I'm going to say preacher because he preaches. Doesn't really pastor a church, but, you know, he tells young people about spiritual things. Bethke is preaching at Liberty University, which, of course, when it was started, was a bastion of fundamentalism, really. Jerry Falwell and the Moral Majority and all that. What's that? Yeah, exactly. And I happen to have two kids who have gone through Liberty University, and I have even watched the change over the years. But one of the things that I have seen is the speakers they bring in for their weekly convo. It's called, not weekly, I think it's every 4 days a week. Convo, it's called, convocation. But not like we typically think in college where you have convocation once, but this is 4 times a week. They call it, and I'm sure it is, the largest gathering of Christian young people in the world. Because 4 days a week, probably 12,000 students gather together in a big auditorium. It's high energy. It's exciting, you know, and they bring in, you know, all the who's who of heresy. Sprinkled in with a few good preachers. And so you can listen to Jefferson Bethke as he's there. And in this particular YouTube, Jefferson Bethke is talking about Genesis chapter 1. And he very quickly goes into, now a lot of scholars say that Genesis 1 is not a historical narrative. Rather what it is a temple poem, he calls it, a temple poem. And basically he says, that's just a story about how to worship. And at the end, when you come in a temple, the last thing you put is the image of God. And here we come, and the last thing God makes is man in the image of God. And so we present ourselves to the world in the image of God. It's a manner of worshiping. Now, again, that just removes all the historical validity of Genesis chapter 1. And Genesis chapter 1, by the way, is about the creation of the world. It's not a temple narrative about how you ought to worship. You can make stuff up about that all you want to. But so this is how pervasive it is in our world today, even though Jefferson Bethke doesn't stand up to Liberty Convocation and say, I want to teach German rationalism today. Well, you'd be kicked. No, you can't teach that if you use the name. But you can teach it all day long as you call it poems and refer to it in such a way. So, German rationalism, this higher criticism method of interpretation, took root in the really 1870s, 1880s, and I'm convinced it's not any mistake at all that it was beginning about 1880s, really about say 1890s, that this whole movement of the plethora of Bible translations came along. Prior to 1900, you had the King James Version, maybe the Geneva Bible. That's what you had. About 1900, I think it was 1901, the American Standard Version came out. 1898, maybe the English Standard Version. No. ESV is the new one. I think maybe it's just called the standard English. I'm not sure. I tell you, today's English Standard Version is built upon the Revised Standard Version, and the Revised Standard Version had something before it was revised. Let's just call it the Standard Version. I've forgotten my history. So the Standard Version was the first one. That was in England. Then there was the American Standard Version. Then later the Revised Standard Version, and then the New American Standard Version. Someday there'll be the New American Standard Version, and then of course you got the New International Version, and all these, and literally in the last 125 years, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Bible translations have come about. All through Christianity, that was not the case. Now, you would argue, well, it's because you didn't have the printing press like you did today. And I'm sure that did help it, but I really think that was not the core issue, because even in the 1950 and prior, even then, to translate and produce a Bible on a mass scale was a mighty expensive thing, much, much more than it is today. But in all those years, all these translations coming about, I'm convinced that you have all these translations, every one of them except the New King James, every other one of them is built upon what's called the critical text. I'll bring an illustration of that in a moment in the sermon. The critical text came about as the child of Julius Wellhausen and the German rationalization. because they began to say, well, if the Bible is these human documents, then we need to go through and pick out of all the various texts, which one do we want? And so they actually created a new Greek text. Then somebody needed to translate that Greek text, and so you got the American Standard Version, the New American Standard Version, blah, 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 all through it goes. And came in again and hit Europe first and killed European Christianity and then jumped the pond to the United States, started in Eastern seminaries like Princeton. Princeton at one time was an Orthodox seminary, believe it or not, a guy named J. Gresham Meacham, something very close to that. He was a professor at Princeton, and he actually saw what was coming here. This is, I think, in the 1920s, maybe the teens, and he wrote a book about what was happening, liberalism and the change in the view of Scripture. He actually left Princeton, started a new seminary, which is called Westminster Theological Seminary, which still exists today, and is much more conservative than Princeton. Meacham and Princeton always came from a Calvinist viewpoint, so Westminster was also Calvinist, but Westminster then became the conservative branch. Princeton left off in its idea of liberalism. And they came to the conclusion then that the books of the Bible, especially Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, were written by four sources, J, E, D, and P. We won't go into all the details of that. But I can tell you, when I went to seminary, I learned that Genesis was written by the J author, the E author, the D author, and the P author. And went through those, and I even remember, I wasn't the smartest kid on the block then, but I remember taking a test one day, and it talked about one particular passage in Genesis, and who wrote it, and the options were J, E, D, and P, and I scratched them out and wrote Moses. And got the question wrong, actually, for as far as the test, but I answered it right. And so it infected, I promise you, every form of denominational Christianity. The only place it didn't affect was little pockets of independent Christianity, independent fundamentalism. Now, you say, well, it didn't affect the Southern Baptists. We've always been conservative. And you drank the Kool-Aid. because I have right here the Brodmann Bible Commentary. And I just happened to pick it up to see, well, what's it say about the inspiration of the Bible? This is the Genesis version. And it talks about four types of inspiration. Here it says, the view of verbal inspiration is usually applied to Scripture in the original language, and goes on, and it talks badly about verbal inspiration. By the way, I believe in verbal inspiration of the Scriptures. But here's some of the things it says about it. There's, seven points against verbal inspiration, but here's number four. Verbal inspiration tends to place all of the Bible on the same level of divine revelation. Anyone catch that? Is there a problem with saying all of the Bible is inspired? No. In fact, I think the Scripture says all Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for, yeah. Well, if you believe verbal inspiration, or as I would say, verbal plenary inspiration, that is, it's words and every word is inspired, then you say all of it is divinely inspired. But the Brodmann Bible Commentary says, number four, the problem with verbal inspiration is it tends to place all the Bible on the same level of divine revelation. Number seven, let's see. Verbal inspiration appears irreconcilable with what seem to be facts growing out of objective research Verbal inspiration appears irreconcilable with what seem to be facts growing out of objective research into and serious study of the Bible. Now, I'll interpret that for you. Our objective human reasoning is studying and finding out that the Bible is wrong. And so objective human reasoning really is the problem. Now, That, again, is in the Broadman Bible Commentary. And I happen to have volume one of the commentary that sparked the what is called the conservative resurgence in the Southern Baptist Convention, because this was so bold that a number of Southern Baptists, like W.A. Criswell, stood up and says, garbage. We're not doing that anymore. And he wrote a book called Why I Believe That the Bible is Literally True. And do you know that the Baptist Sunday School Board refused to print his book, Why I Believe That the Bible is Literally True? And the only reason they ever printed it was because the messengers meeting in Denver, I believe it was, of the Southern Baptist Convention finally passed a resolution insisting that the Baptist Sunday School Board print it. When they did, many of the Baptist Sunday School Board members resigned in protest. You ought to read it this Sunday. It's a great book, by the way, Why I Believe That the Bible is Literally True. And he preaches that the Bible is literally true. And tells why. So all of this infected even Baptist, Southern Baptist, definitely. Now, so what you've got after Julius Wellhausen is you've got liberal Christianity and conservative Christianity. Which is which? Because nobody, for the most part, at least today, nobody wanted to claim we're liberals. And this was the problem. I remember, again, as growing up, of course, I went to a Baptist college and I went to a Baptist seminary, and I was convinced, because I read the Baptist paper, that we were conservative. And the bad guys in the Southern Baptist Convention were the fundamentalist, right? In fact, I couldn't have said this 10 years ago from a pulpit, but I can today. They were called the fundamentalist. And they were the bad guys. And even the fundamentalists within the Southern Baptist Convention didn't want to be called fundamentalist. I do, by the way. You can call me that all day long. But they didn't want to be. And I drank the Kool-Aid enough to know, okay, everybody's conservative. I remember even as a college student and a seminary student, and I was in the seminary at the time, this was all a heated debate. Russell Dilday was president of the seminary. He later got fired when enough fundamentalists finally took over. And students marched on the campus and how horrible this actually was. And why did we, that was a little after I left, but so I wasn't marching, but we didn't think we were liberals. But go back and read the stuff that was being taught, and I can tell you, we were liberals, no doubt about it. And it's made a little bit of improvement, not far enough for this fundamentalist, but anyway. Here's the tenets of liberalism. We're here because of an evolutionary process. And how do we know that? Almighty Darwin taught us that. In liberalism, thou shalt not speak against Darwin. He got it right. We're here because of an evolutionary process. That's liberalism. Then, not only has the body evolved, but the mind has evolved as well. So our thinking today is better than thinking in the past. Third, in this evolution, the ideas of man have obviously evolved. And so, very closely related, the ideas of man today are better than the ideas of man yesterday. Well, since our ideas have evolved, we now think about God differently. We mankind used to think about a God of judgment, requiring payment for sin, but now we think of God as love and all these evolved different views of God. And God of love, he's not offended by some sort of archaic idea that man had of sin, but rather he's offended by a lack of enlightenment. God loves enlightenment. And the answer to a lack of enlightenment is education. And so what we need today is to educate people. Enlighten people, and that would bring the spark of divinity alive within them. We know this today because we've evolved. Our grandparents didn't know this because they were Neanderthals. And then, finally, when man is enlightened, there will be no more war, no more hatred, no more famine. Well, that's liberalism. It never has proven to be true, but nonetheless, that is liberalism. In the United States, something cropped up that was the antidote to Julius Wellhausen, the father of all of this liberalism, and what cropped up is really something uniquely American, and that is fundamentalism, as it relates to Christianity. Fundamentalism as it relates to Christianity. This is the idea that, I'll give the tenets here in just a moment, but they looked at Europe and said, you know what, the Europes have become rationalists, the European Christians, they're rationalizing. They're saying, if you believe in verbal plenary inspiration, then, you know, it goes against human reason, and human reason is God, and so, you know, and there were these hicks in the United States that lived by and large in small towns and small churches, and they just were independent enough to say, no, the Bible is true. The Bible is inerrant. The Bible was given by God. And this fundamentalism took root in small cities and towns, but eventually, starting from the East and working West, having less success in the East than anywhere else in the West, so American fundamentalism really did best from the Appalachians onward. It eventually had these tabernacles that were filled with huge, unheard of kind of crowds of people. You think of someone like D.L. Moody, who at one time in his church, he had 10,000 people that were in the room and another 6,000 people outside of the room. This huge crowds that was coming from these fundamentalist movements, and all of that fundamentalist movement was a, if I could say it was the Tea Party against German rationalism. And there was a guy in Fort Worth, a Baptist, named J. Frank Norris. You ought to read about J. Frank Norris sometime. He was one of the most colorful preachers that ever lived. And in fact, there's a book out there called The Shooting Salvationist. It's a secular book about J. Frank Norris, but it's very interesting reading because J. Frank Norris, on a Saturday night in downtown Fort Worth at the First Baptist Church Fort Worth, where he was pastor, had a fellow came in that had threatened him before and threatened him again, and J. Frank Norris pulled his revolver out and shot him dead, stone cold dead. Got up and preached the next morning, and life went on. But anyway, you had this trial, Ma Ferguson, and all the, she was the governor of Texas. I mean, everybody, it literally was the trial of the century that was going on. J. Frank Norris was very well known, had a newspaper that went all over the place. But in Fort Worth, Texas, he would have, on Sunday nights was the big time. Sunday mornings, he had a big church as well. But Sunday nights, they actually left the church, would go to outdoor places where they could meet, and literally every Sunday night, 10,000, 12,000, 15,000 people would come together and hear this fundamentalist, J. Frank Norris, preach his sermon. This was the modernist fundamentalist controversy, all in time of the Scopes trial, all this kind of stuff. And that kind of fundamentalism really affected American Christianity. There was no such thing in European Christianity. And I would say, even though, again, a number of my Southern Baptist brethren would talk about the fundamentalist, I'd say they saved America. Without them, American Christianity would have been exactly the same thing as European Christianity, which is long dead. The five tenets of fundamentalism were the inerrancy of Scripture, the deity of Christ, the finished work of the cross, the salvation by grace alone, and the premillennial return of Jesus Christ. Just across the board, the D.L. Moody's, the J. Frank Norris's, all these guys, Billy Sundays, whatever, they all held to these five things. Now, fundamentalism is for all but a few very small pockets, I would say fundamentalism is dead in America today, and I don't think this is a good thing for America's future. I think that it's going to bring about the same thing that you've got in European Christianity, and fundamentalism about the 1940s. fundamentalists had a baby, and that baby was called evangelicalism. The evangelical is the son of the fundamentalist, so to speak. Evangelicalism was, if you will, a softer, kinder fundamentalism. Softer, gentler, is that what did George Bush say? A softer, gentler kind of, he was talking about conservatism, but that was evangelicalism. And evangelicalism was less willing to, you know, stand up and fight and die and all those kind of things. The major issue to tell, are you an evangelical or a fundamentalist, is an evangelical will get involved in ecumenical events. A fundamentalist will not get involved in ecumenical events. So you say, I believe all those five things, whatever. It's ecumenicalism really that is the bellwether issue on there. And again, I think saved that kind of fundamentalism actually saved America from being where Europe is today. So Julius Wellhausen came along in the 1870s, 1880s. And he began to teach rationalism, that the human mind has evolved to the point that we now know that the Bible wasn't given to us by direct revelation from God. As odd as it may sound to some of you, because you came from evangelical or fundamentalist backgrounds, as odd as that sounds to some of you, the vast majority of the Christian world holds to rationalism today. The idea that the Bible is something other than the inspired, verbally inspired Word of God given down to us. One interesting, out of time here, but I'll go ahead and give you one interesting tidbit about German rationalism in the among Southern Baptists. I've given you a commentary there, but at Southern Seminary in the late 1800s, Southern Seminary was at that time probably, I think it was our only seminary, the only Southern Baptist seminary. It's in Louisville, Kentucky. They had a professor named Crawford Toy, T-O-Y. And Dr. Toy was, from everything we can tell, he was brilliant. And he was a brilliant linguist, Hebrew scholar, and everybody on campus said, this is the smartest guy in the Southern Seminary. Well, he began teaching German rationalism. And eventually, J.P. Boyce, who was the president of the seminary at that time, Boyce eventually had to fire him, because enough people were saying, this is German rationalism, we don't go into it. And so he was eventually fired. He went on to a very distinguished career at Harvard University. But here's the interesting trivial tidbit, the only thing you need to know, is that he was engaged to a young missionary to China whose name was Lottie Moon. That's right. Crawford Toy and Lottie Moon were engaged. Lottie Moon actually wrote a letter. In fact, Crawford Toy, who is this great linguist, he said, nobody can write more beautiful letters than Lottie Moon. She has perfect English. Lottie Moon actually wrote back to the Foreign Mission Board and said, I am engaged to be married to Crawford Toy. Make preparations. I'll be done because I'm marrying Crawford Toy. Later on, actually, she called off the engagement and did not get married to Crawford Toy. And she called it off because she said, his theology is not my theology, and he's drifting into areas I can't go. And so the marriage was called off. And now you know the rest of the story. Let me lead us in a word of prayer.